Shalom, and welcome to Via Havta Yisrael, a Hebrew phrase which means, you shall love Israel. We hope you'll stay with us for the next 30 minutes as our teacher, Dr. Baruch, shares his expository teaching from the Bible. Dr. Baruch is the senior lecturer at the Zera Avraham Institute based in Israel. Although all courses are taught in Hebrew at the Institute, Dr. Baruch is pleased to share this weekly address in English. To find out more about our work in Israel, please visit us on the web at loveisrael.org. That's one word, loveisrael.org. Now, here's Baruch with today's lesson.
Are you frustrating the work of God in your life? Many people ask the question, why doesn't God want to bless me? Why doesn't God want to help me? Why doesn't God want to heal me? Well, the truth of the matter is that God loves to bless people. We see over and over in the prayers of Israel that God is referred to as a blessed God. The reason why we don't experience the good things that He wants us to is because we're frustrating His work in our life. And that's exactly what we see in the seventh chapter of the prophecy of Hosea. So with that said, take out your Bible and look there. The prophecy of Hosea in chapter 7. Now, the first thing that we see here is that God wants to heal Israel. He says in verse 1, when I wanted to heal Israel, something took place. Now, God knew that Israel was not walking in obedience, and He knew that if that change was going to come about, it required that He worked in their life. But Israel wasn't wanting that change. Now, they might have been crying out, they might have been praying for it, but they did not want to see a real holy transformation come over the people of Israel. Much of the time in the prophecy of Hosea, we're dealing with the leaders, those who were prophets, the kings of Israel, the cabinet members of the government. And what I want you to see is, no sooner does God say, when I would have healed you, O Israel, what takes place? Look on in verse 1. The iniquity of Ephraim was manifested. The evil things, and by the way, that word is in the plural. It's simply the Hebrew word ra'ot. Ra'ot in the plural means evil, but abundant evil. It shows that no serious desire among the people to transform. So let me ask you a question. Are you wanting to be different? Are you wanting the transformation that God is able, willing, and desiring to see become a reality in your life happen? So we read here, the iniquity of Ephraim was manifested, the evil things of Shomron. And Shomron, well, that was the capital of this northern kingdom. Remember, for the most part, we're talking about those 10 northern tribes. And what I want you to see here in this passage of scripture is that the people, the Israelites, what were they doing? It says, for they were functioning, doing, acting. That's what that word means. They were functioning according not to the truth of God, but notice that word, sheker, falsehood. And we're going to see a relationship between when we approach God according to falsehood, we're going to find the truth. And what's the truth? His covenantal promises. When we operate in that which is false, what we're doing is we're saying no to the promises of God that He desires greatly to become a reality in your life and my life. Now, why is that? Because when we receive the covenantal promises of God, one of the outcome, because those promises happen out of obedience, is that God's glory is manifested. And there's an inherent relationship in the scripture between God's glory being manifested and the faithfulness of the people. So God wants to see the faithfulness of the people, His glory being manifested, and the outcome is the nations are going to take note of this, and they're going to respond. So look again at verse 1. It says, for they function in falsehood. And when we do that, what it's like? It is like inviting the enemy to come into our lives. Why do I say that? Last part of verse 1, and the thief will come. Now, this word for thief, it is related in this context to the enemy. And the enemy's going to come, and he's coming to do what? to deny, to steal, to take away those things that God wants us to have. But when we hinder, frustrate, quench that Holy Spirit, we're going to see that God moves away, and that is that invitation for the enemy to come. And notice that he comes in a most powerful way. Oftentimes in the scripture, when we refer to God, especially prophetically, we speak about Hashem Tzevaot, that is, the God of the heavenly armies. So God is able, he's powerful to accomplish his will, like a group of many, many powerful armies. Well, here, in speaking about the enemy, it says that the enemy, and it uses the term, perhaps many Bibles, I think what's on the screen says gang, but it's also a military term. In modern Hebrew, it's used to speak about a battalion, so a group, a large group of soldiers. And it says here that they will spread out before the people, that is outside them, ready to attack. Well, let's move on to verse 2. It says, they do not say to their hearts all their evil that I will remember. Now, we talked about the fact that this word remember is a covenantal word. It's the word lizkor. The first time that we see it in the scripture in a very significant way is in the book of Genesis, when God says that he is going to look upon the keshet, that rainbow, and remember his covenant with Noah, that is Noah. So this word is always related to a covenantal condition. So God here, it says, they don't think that I'm going to remember their evilness, their iniquity, their sin. Well, what's he speaking about? Well, remember, part of the covenant is the law. And when he speaks here about this covenant, there's a covenant which brings about blessings, but that same covenant, if we are not walking in the obedience to the will of God, and the word here is ra. Ra means that which is against the will of God. So if we are walking in obedience to the will of God, that is the word tov. Tov is related to the will of God. When we're experiencing the will of God in our life, submitting to it, obeying it, being people who are led by it, we're going to be blessed. But when we are operating in ra, that is evil, contrary to the will of God, what's going to be the outcome? The outcome is going to be God's judgment, his condemnation, or in a covenantal sense, we use the terminology curse. So he says, you know, they don't say in the heart. They're not considering that I remember all their evilness. He says, now they do something. He says, they surround them with what? They surround themselves with evil deeds before my face they were. So God is speaking here that when he looks at Israel, what does he see? Evilness. He sees deeds that are in conflict with the commandments of God. And because of that, and remember, I say this a lot, because they're not walking in obedience, they're not going to experience the intimacy, the togetherness of God in their lives. That's what he speaks about here when he says, they set before me those evil deeds before my face. Face of God is going to be used for two things, either blessing or cursing. Whenever something comes before the face, the presence of God, he's going to respond. And that's what he's telling the people here. He's going to respond to them. Well, press on to verse 3. We see here, in their evilness. Now, in this passage, what we see over and over is this word, ra. And we're going to see the outcome of it. There is outcome from the will of God, but there's also an outcome, a result. A result from that which is contrary to his truth. So in verse 3 it says, in their evilness, the king will rejoice. Now here's a problem. What the prophet is trying to say is that the leadership of the children of Israel is wrong. Those kings are not appointed by God. We'll see that later on. They're not functioning according to the truth of God. They're not kings that are concerned with the covenant of God. They're not even kings that worship the God of Israel. So in their evilness, the people, the king rejoices. And in there, and this word is also a synonym for the word evil. It is the word falsehood, or that which denies the things of God. It says, and in their denial, it says, are the leaders. Now, the word here is the word sar, which is a very important leader. Today in Israel, it's used for a cabinet officer. So someone who advises the king. So what's happening here? All the leadership is excited. They're happy that the things of their kingdom are not in accordance with truth. Why? Because they don't want to live according to the truth. Their government is not based upon the truth. It's based upon the desires that they have coming from their flesh. Verse 4. All of them are adulterers. Now, we've talked about the fact that in the book of Hosea and in prophecy in general, there's a relationship between adultery and idolatry. But for the next few minutes, I want to talk about adultery. Because what we see is this. Idolatry just didn't happen. The people had to make some cognitive decisions. And those decisions were seen, measured out, not by just thoughts, but by deeds. There was preparation that goes involved for idolatry. So there was a process. And what I want you to see is that there is a process to adultery. Why do I say that? We'll look again at verse 4. All of them are adulterers, for they are like, and here's the key, they are like a burning oven from baking. And it says that those who, and the idea here is that those who need the basek, that is the dough, those who need the dough, they don't get up from their work, meaning after the dough is needed, these people don't get up until the dough is ready. It says here, until it has become sour. That is a Hebrew idiom. So what do they do? Well, they heat up the oven. They get the dough ready. Everything is put into place. And then there's time required. Because you can't put that dough into the oven unless that oven has reached a certain temperature and that dough is in a proper condition. So there's a process for the outcome to be realized. And that same thing is true in adultery. I cannot tell you the number of people that I've sat down with, married individuals that come, and what's the problem? Well, adultery has plagued their relationship. And the guilty one, they almost always say the same thing. They say, you know, I don't know how it happened. I mean, it just took place. I didn't know what I was doing. It was just happened, done, and over before I even knew it. Now, if God's really going to bring about healing in that person, that spiritual renewal, if that person is going to find forgiveness, then they have to begin operating in the truth. And the truth is not that adultery just happens. It is a process that requires time. This is what normally happens. Let's take a couple. And the husband has a job and he committed adultery with a fellow employee. This is what happens. He begins talking to her more and more. They become just not speaking about things related to work, but they begin to speak about personal things, just whatever, just chit chat. And then they find themselves when a group of people go out to lunch, well, they go and they sit next to one another. And then as people go out to lunch infrequently or frequently, they decide to travel in the same car. And then lo and behold, they decide, well, no one else wants to go out to lunch today, but we'll go out to lunch today. And they have a few dinners. They are harmless, they think. I mean, they both have to eat. They don't like to be alone. So no one else wanted to go. So why not? What could it hurt? Just two people talking. And then what happens? Little by little, there is more intimacy, personal intimacy, and then you know the rest of the story. What I want you to see is this, and this is what the scripture is trying to say is, adultery, idolatry, that which is faithless, it doesn't happen just out of the blue. There is a process, there is a cognitive thought process that goes through before that sin manifests, and that's what he's saying here. We'll press on to verse 5. We read, the day of our king The leaders made him sick with wine. And why was that? Well, it says, so that he would remove his hand into the folly. So what they wanted to do was to bring him down to the same levels as they were. There was unrighteous leadership, and that begat an unrighteous king. And they influenced him in order to have that same folly, that is, that same concept of thinking that causes someone to walk in disobedience. It's when we are just trying to have a good time, rather cognitively thinking about obedience to the Word of God, seeking and pursuing the truth of God. When we don't do those things, we're going to see that the enemy begins to function in our life. He changes our thought process. We become more and more rational rather than operating based upon the revelation of truth through the Word of God and the revelation of the Holy Spirit in our life. And what happens? Sin is going to manifest itself and bring about destruction. Destruction in our family, destruction in our business, destruction of the joy that God wants us to have, and destruction of the people that God wants us to be. So verse 6. Now, verse 6 talks about, once again, preparation, about the people drawing near, but it's an idiom. They are preparing their hearts as they did for the furnace, still using this image of a baking. So in the same way that a baker, he would prepare that oven in order that it's nice and hot in the next day, in the same way, we need to prepare our hearts. But the problem here is this. The people are preparing their lives for an ambush. That is this. They are cognitively planning and living for a capture. But what type of capture? Not the things of God. See, here's the problem. The people are not using the principles that God would have them to use to obtain obedience, faithfulness before God. They're using that same discipline, but applying it to idolatry, applying it to serving the enemy, applying that same way of achieving so that they might achieve their desires and not the desires of God. So in that same way, all night long, middle of verse 6, all night long they sleep, that is the bakers, but in the morning, that thing, it says, he, meaning the furnace, it is ready, it's burning with flames of fire, verse 7. For all of them are hot, like a tanur. That is, they prepared themselves, they're ready for sin. And because of that, what's going to be the outcome? It says they're going to be partakers of their judgment. For all their kings have fallen, and there's not any among them that call out to me. So what we have here is emptiness. We have an example of the people being alone, no one to help. And even in the midst of this, we're going to see God is ready. God is allowing them to be brought to that low point in their life to call out, but they don't do that. See, some of them, and realize this is not just happening over a period of weeks or months or years, but we're talking about generations. And so many of that next generation, the generation after that, they have not been discipled. They don't know the truths of God. They don't know how to respond to God, and they're helpless. That's what it's saying here. There are the majority of the prophets are not prophets of God, so there's no revelation. And without revelation, what does the scripture say? The people perish. So Israel in this time is in a very difficult situation. Look on to verse 8. Once again, we're talking about Ephraim. And here, Ephraim is just that northern kingdom. The word comes from a Hebrew verb that means fruitfulness. But Ephraim is anything but fruitful during this time. So we read in verse 8, Ephraim will be among the people. And what will happen? Well, they use a term, Yitbolel. Yitbolel comes from the Hebrew phrase, hitbolelut, which means assimilation. Now, here's the problem. See, there is nothing that is static, spiritually speaking. The spirit is always at move. Your spiritual condition is always changing. It's moving in either one of two directions. Your spiritual condition is either maturing and growing and becoming like God would want it to be, or the exact opposite is taking place. And when you look here in this passage, it says Ephraim is assimilating. What does that mean? Ephraim is becoming like the nations. They're like, it says, Ephraim. He was a cake without turning over. Now, what that means is this. He's half-baked. On the outside, if you put a cake in, and this time what they would do is they would put a cake in for about two-thirds of its time, it would look fine, but it wasn't cooked thoroughly on the inside. So they would flip it over, and then the inside would cook and finish up. But if you didn't turn it over, if you just judge by the outward appearance, you would think that cake is fine and ready to eat. But when you cut into it, you find that it's anything but edible. Well, that's Ephraim spiritually speaking. Outwardly, he looks fine, doesn't seem to have any problems. And oftentimes people, if you just look on the outward, I mean, they dress nicely, they live in a nice home, they seem to be successful, they seem to be happy, they might laugh, they might joke, they might be the life of the party. But inwardly, they're what? They are miserable. Now, here's something that I think is a very interesting statistic. I came across this a few weeks ago, but unfortunately, the suicide rate is on the increase. And this is what I want you to hear. When they talk to the spouse or the closest family members of the one who committed suicide, most of them were surprised by their actions. They could not imagine this one taking his life, her life. It was so far removed from what they thought was the reality of that person's thoughts. They didn't know. So many times people can look fine outwardly, but inwardly, they are bankrupt. And that's exactly what the spiritual condition was of Ephraim. Well, move on to verse 9. It says, foreigners. Now, this is the enemy. This is the nations. It says, foreigners will devour his power, and he won't even know. He is not perceptive to understand what's going on spiritually, how the enemy is getting a hand over him. It goes on to say, and also the term seva. Seva is gray hair. It's an idiom for being old. Age comes. And that means that there's a sensitivity of time. Time is running out. And also, old age in the scripture should have to do with wisdom. And what it's saying here is that the people are insensitive. They're unaware of the time of their life. They have not seeing the effects of time in their life positively coming about, meaning they have not learned, they not have matured, they're not becoming the people that God wants them to. And it says, for he does not know this, he's not aware of it. Verse 10, therefore the pride of Israel will answer. Now, what it's saying is, Israel's acting in a very prideful way. What does that mean? They're acting based upon what they want and not what God wants. And therefore, there's going to be a result of that. So the pride of Israel is going to respond before him. And it says, and they will not what? They will not return to their God, the Lord their God, for they will not seek him in all of this. So all of this sorrow, all of this hardship, this lack of power, this frustration, we began in chapter 7, verse 1. They needed healing. They're not receiving that. So they're empty. They're bankrupt. They're miserable. And what's happening? They are not turning to God. They won't seek his assistance. Why is that? Verse 11. For Ephraim is like a foolish dove that has no heart. When it says has no heart, it means no mind. They don't have the intelligence to respond spiritually. Why? Because they do not know the truth of this book. They are not aware of the revelation of the Word of God, so they're not able to respond to God. It says Egypt is synonymous with exile, those bad things, those bad experiences. Israel will hear the Egyptians call, and they'll go to what? Assyria. Why? Well, Israel is going to be abolished, and that is they're going to be sent to Assyria. So Egypt, all the things of Egypt, what they were experiencing in this generation, and they're going to once again go into exile. Verse 12, and as they go, I will spread over them my net as a bird of the heavens. I'm going to bring them down, and I'm going to discipline them. God is speaking that their congregation might hear. That is, that the people might hear. So God is going to discipline Israel, and his hope is that the congregation of Israel, that is, the ones who are faithful, that remnant, that they will learn more about God, and that they will begin to have an effect, a spiritual effect upon those around them. See, many times there are people who love God, they live in the truth, they are following biblical principles, but they're not being that testimony, and that's what it's saying here. God wants them to be a testimony. Verse 13, woe to them, for they have wandered away from me, and destruction is going to be against them, for they have transgressed me. For I would have redeemed them, they who say unto me falsehood. So God would have done so, but the problem is these people are saying what? They're speaking falsely before God. Verse 14, they do not cry out unto me in their hearts, for upon their beds, what do? They wail. That is, they do show signs of displeasure. But here's the problem. This is what I want you to see. They are calling out to God, not because of their spiritual condition, not because they want him, but notice what it says here. They cry out over the corn and over the new wine. And what do? Well, here's an important thing. They literally say, and some Bibles misunderstand this because some of the manuscripts confuse one of the Hebrew letters. This is the word to gash, to cut yourself. And what it's trying to tell us is the spiritual condition of these people. See, instead of turning to God properly, what are they doing? They're cutting themselves, which is a pagan act. So they don't even know how properly to respond to God. So they cut themselves. They show idolatrous practices, and God turns away. He says, I discipline them that I might strengthen their arms unto me. What? That I might strengthen their arms unto me. They think that all of this is evil. They return, but not to the God Most High. For they are a broken vessel. That is a broken what? A broken weapon. And what happens? It says here that they're going to fall by the sword. There's not going to be a production of faithfulness to them. Well, we're out of time until next week when we move on to chapter 8.
Well, we hope you will benefit from today's message and share it with others. Please plan to join us each week at this time and on this channel for our broadcast of loveisrael.org. Again, to find out more about us, please visit our website, loveisrael.org. There you will find articles and numerous other lectures by Baruch. These teachings are in video form. You may download them or watch them in streaming video. Until next week, may the Lord bless you in our Messiah Yeshua, that is, Jesus, as you walk with Him. Shalom from Israel.